idea.
You're referring to the Henderson paper where they looked at axona,
yes,
yeah, AC1202. So the finding was in that study, which is relatively small, that
yeah.
at least not with the diet, but using a ketone supplement that was formulated with 20 grams of medium chain triglycerides. So they gave it to their patients, I think just once a day. And they did show fairly convincingly that the elevation of beta-hydroxybutyrate correlated with an improvement in cognitive function. But that correlation was not observed in the APOE-4 positive group. Yeah, which was a little bit, it's kind of surprising. I would like to see that study done using the ketogenic diet, or maybe the ketogenic diet formulated with ketone supplementation. But so the question is, it didn't have a negative effect, but
yeah.
the question is, you know, why didn't it have a positive effect?
Was there not another study where they actually did the ketone supplement, beta-hydroxybutyrate? I thought there was, but I could be mistaken just for my lack of understanding.
Yeah.
Because that
C8
would shed
is
some more light.
Yeah. They use caprylic triglyceride, C8, which kind of makes a lot of ketones, relatively speaking.
Unless the APOE is changing the way you're making ketones, right?
Good fatty acid.
But they measured. You said they measured beta hydroxybutyrate in everyone, and
yeah.
the levels were the same. Levels were the same because it's like I want to understand why.
Yeah.
Why there was no positive benefit in APOE4 mm-hmm. carriers? Because that's the one thing that it seems so promising,
mm-hmm.
right?
That
these ketone potentially ketone supplements mm-hmm. or a ketogenic diet could help modulate, you know, Alzheimer's disease.
Yeah, and I think you could do it in different ways. My student presented yesterday, she presented this week, but she graduated with her PhD yesterday, and her work showed that there's a remarkable increase in blood flow. And previous work had shown that ketone bodies can increase brain blood flow by 30 to 40%. So that's another, when you have vascular dementia, when you have a decrease,
yeah.
you know, that being, staying in a state of
or just brain
ketosis,
aging in general.
Yeah. Can have a profound
effect.
Do you know,
did she understand any of the mechanisms, or do you know? Can you talk about it?
Yeah, we're looking at that. Well, we did ischemic wounds, which, I mean, I guess you could kind of relate to an aged brain, right,
mm-hmm.
with clogged arteries. We did a Doppler blood flow measurement and showed that it spiked up considerably when we can elevate ketones. One of the things, it was not dependent upon VEGF. So we looked at all the different factors. So VEGF was not increased in the wound. And we looked at a couple other things that we thought would be increased. The one thing that stood out in the data was adenosine. So adenosine levels are significantly elevated. Now, adenosine is sort of thought to make us sleepy. You know, when we drink coffee, it's like adenosine receptor antagonist. There's high levels of ATP sort of being used, and we think that they may be causing an elevation of adenosine. But we really have to delve into the metabolomics to understand why that's happening. Regardless, adenosine is a very powerful vasodilator. And it's in higher concentration significantly in the blood, and that may be increasing the perfusion of tissues, peripheral tissues.
That's
and I think losing. Yeah.
Did it have any effect on the blood-brain barrier at all? Like, did you look at that?
We haven't looked at that. My colleague has been kind of looking at that a little bit. We know with fasting and the ketogenic diet that you can increase permeability to the blood-brain barrier. Things
you
get
mean
through faster.
Ketosis through fasting, or
well,
both combining
yeah,
the two.
Sort of, yeah. Fasting induced ketosis, or even the ketogenic diet, can help increase the permeability of the blood-brain barrier to a wide variety of things. So, if you are sort of the implications from his perspective that if you're getting a chemotherapeutic drug, if you're getting some kind of drug that needs to cross the blood-brain barrier that's impaired in some way, you might be able to get that across faster in a state of, you know, fasting ketosis or the ketogenic diet. So maybe if you're fasting, maybe, you know, there's just less stuff in your blood, there's competition of things getting through, and your blood's sort of clear, and you introduce the drug and you get more rapid transport because there's co-transporters and other things, or things that might be in your diet that may be impeding transport. There's multiple independent lines of evidence to suggest that being in a state of ketosis can help better transport things across. But, you know, when we talk about permeabilizing the blood-brain barrier, that's like a bad thing, right? Making it more right. permeable. But I, in general, though, you get a knockdown of neuroinflammation from the diet and from therapy to ketosis, which is something the epilepsy world is very interested in. So there's this PET scan technique that allows us to look at neuroinflammation in the brain.
Yeah.
And we know that this is a conference that I recently came from, that may be an excellent predictor of when someone's going to have a seizure.